All right. If everyone could take their seats, please. Hello, and welcome to our 4 o'clock press conference, Plunging Below the Ionosphere. Our speakers are Cassandra Fiesen, Air Force Research Laboratory, Kirtland Air Force Base, Rod Helis, Principal Investigator, Cindy, the University of Texas at Dallas, and Rob Pfaff, Project Scientist, Cindy, NASA Goddard Space Flight Center.
Good afternoon, and thank you all for coming. CNOFS is a Communication Navigation Outage Forecast System satellite. It was launched by the Air Force in April of 2008, and its job was to investigate the space environment through which it was traveling. That is, the charged and neutral particles that are up here, how they were distributed, how they react to neutral winds and electric fields, magnetic fields, and so forth. This plot shows the perigee altitude of CNOFS starting from the day it was launched up to the very end. At the end of November, CNOFS actually re-entered the day after Thanksgiving about midnight California time. And you can see in the last 2 years or so, we had a big decrease in the altitude as it started to come in. So this gave us a golden opportunity to make some really rare measurements. We've had very few observations of an uncontrolled satellite reentry, and CNOFS was fully functional right up to the very end. All the instruments were still working. So we're showing here that this is solar activity. This is we put this on here because the neutral density increases as solar activity increases, so that's going to have a lot to say about the reentry period and how the spacecraft actually re-enters. One thing we learned from this is that it's really, really hard to predict when a spacecraft will actually come in. There were a bunch of groups that were making predictions, and even 3 days out, the kind of the prevailing consensus was that it was going to burn up over the coast of Ecuador, and instead it burned up over Ethiopia, as best we can tell. So we were only like half a world off, but you know. So we hope that observations that we can take, like we obtained during this reentry period, will help us be able to improve the models and improve our reentry predictions. So the people working on CNOFS, we had a bunch of instruments from 5 different institutions. We had terrific partnerships with all these people. We had University of Texas at Dallas, NASA Goddard Space Flight Center, the Aerospace Corporation, the Naval Research Lab, and the Air Force Research Lab. And you'll hear from these two PIs in a few minutes. But first, let me give you a little bit of a background on, you know, more information on CNOFS, the mission. So CNOFS at the Air Force, we tend to think of as a mission in 3 acts. And Act 1 was the original mission, Troubles with Bubbles, because you'll find out why that is in a second. This has to do with a real-world problem, is satellite communication issues. I mean, sometimes you know that satellite communications are disrupted or garbled or sometimes completely lost. And CNOFS was trying to help us figure out why that happened and, you know, where and when and so forth. So this little cartoon is just depicting what the situation. So normally we think of the ionosphere as very quiet, undisturbed. It's a layer of charged particles. And we have, you know, this satellite communication signal can easily pass through the ionosphere and be received down here at the ground or by at aircraft or ships or whatever. However, the ionosphere is very frequently not quiet, especially at low latitudes. It can be very disturbed. It can show turbulence, instabilities, things called bubbles. I mean, these are regions of depleted or very low electron densities, like holes in the ionosphere. And if the signal from the spacecraft, the satellite communication, goes through there, it can get really distorted. And that will cause the signal to either fade or to drop out completely, or you lose the signal or you lose lock. And this phenomenon is called scintillation. The signal is said to be scintillated. And this little old data down here shows you how this could look on a recorder. I mean, here you have the signal from this quiet period over here. And then suddenly you see these wild oscillations. And that's what is bad. And that's called scintillation. And the signal is said to be scintillated. So CNOFS had a lot to do. I mean, its mission was to figure out, you know, how, when, and why these disruptions happened and how they affect our satellite, you know, systems. So, and we've done a lot of good work on that, and we continue to work on that. At the end of 2013, we had faced Act 2, which was also another study of the low-latitude ionosphere structure. And this was motivated by these very interesting observations shown here. So this is an all-sky imager camera of a particular wavelength looking up at the overhead sky, okay? And you take a snapshot. So this was a person in Japan, and he saw these types of structures. And what these are enhancements and depletions in electron density, or, again, bubbles. And now you can see that these bubbles can be actually very, you know, long. So the real interesting thing was that someone in Australia took the same type of measurements at the exact same time and saw very much the same thing. If you look at this here and this, this blue here and the dark here and this here, almost exactly the same thing. But these are thousands of miles apart, you know, so what the heck is going on? And we thought there could be an interesting application here. This means, you know, this turns out to be not a freak occurrence. This happens fairly regularly at low latitudes. So this kind of implies that if you took measurements down here of bubbles, you know what's going to be going on up here, even where you don't have any observations or any instruments or anything, which is kind of cool. So the big question is, why does this happen? And the answer has a lot to do with the Earth's magnetic field. I mean, I think you all probably know that the Earth has a magnetic field. We tend to think of it as lines extending from, you know, pole to pole in the north-south direction. So these are field lines around the equator. And also shown here are the fields of view of these two imagers. And now you can see how they're connected. Right, these imagers fall at the feet of the same field lines, or at the conjugate points. So it is indeed the magnetic field that has a lot to do with how these phenomenon, you know, occur. And we realize that CNOFS flies right through these field lines. So CNOFS can give us measurements right in situ, you know, right where, you know, all these things are going on, unlike these, which are just taking pictures from the ground. So we've done some very good work on this with colleagues at Boston College to try to figure out, you know, how these things occur, and it's still an area of active interest for us. So about a year and a half ago, we came to Act 3, which is basically CNOFS' swan song. This was, we called the Thermospheric Research and Reentry Experiment, or T-REX. We like that name because CNOFS at this point was a bit of a dinosaur. It had lived past its nominal lifetime. And we also knew it was going extinct, so it seemed like an appropriate term. And so this is occurring in, like I said, the last year and a half or so, when we have the satellite coming in very quickly right up to the reentry. And these show the type of measurements that you can take during this period. So, and I'll go over these real quickly and then explain them more. So this is showing the momentum wheel speeds. The momentum wheels are the things that keep the spacecraft oriented properly. And this is showing the spacecraft coordinate system for CNOFS. Basically what we wanted was for CNOFS to be flying like this, all right? So this is my orbit and it's supposed to go like that, all right? So in the picture it would be, you know, going along in this direction. And the ram angle is the thing that tells me how good my pointing is. I would like the ram angle to be zero, and that means it's oriented exactly right. This is a disturbance time index. This is that shows either solar activity or magnetic activity. The key thing to look at here is whenever you see a big dip like this, that means you're going to see something going on in the Earth's upper atmosphere. And then down here we have neutral densities over several days in June of this year. So you can see the neutral densities are just kind of going along, you know, not doing much, and then suddenly, bam, you get this big increase right here when you have this, you know, disturbance index showing up. The densities increase by a factor of 4 or more in this region, and that caused the spacecraft to wobble a bit. It was like, you know, it was in a much denser environment now, and it started losing its orientation a little bit. The ram angle changed up to 6 degrees, which doesn't sound like a lot, but for the folks that do reentry predictions, this was new information and welcome information that they could now start folding into their models, because this wasn't a very big storm at all. So, and the reason that this happened, we think, has to do with the momentum wheels. You can see they suddenly slow down. So it was as if they hit this big region of enhanced density. It was like you put a brake on them. And they slowed way down, and then they overshot when they tried to compensate, and then they bounced a little around a little as they came back. So, as I said, these types of simultaneous measurements are extremely rare, especially at low altitudes. especially for an uncontrolled satellite reentry period. So we were very fortunate to be able that CNOFS was functioning right up to the very end. In fact, the last bits of data that we got were just 13 hours before CNOFS burned in. So we have a really wonderful data set, which you'll hear more about from my colleagues. We had wonderful partnerships, and it was just an extraordinary mission, an extraordinary opportunity to look at, like I said, the bottom side ionosphere and the low altitude reentry region. So now I'll turn it over to my colleagues, and this is starting with Dr. Rod Helos from the University of Texas at Dallas.
Hey, thanks, Cassandra. So I'd like to talk to you a little bit about the final mission phase that Cassandra just described a little bit, and talk to you about the neutral density measurements that were made simultaneously during this final phase reentry period, which are really quite striking. First of all, just a little perspective. On the left here is just the apogee and perigee of the satellite during this final mission phase, and I just want to put that into some perspective for you by noting that the neutral atmosphere has its maximum density near the surface of the Earth, of course, and just decreases uniformly with altitude, where the ionosphere is a layer with a peak near 300 kilometers. And in many ways, this area here below 400 kilometers and on down is really a sweet spot for interaction between the charged particles and the neutral particles. And so many of the variations, as we'll see, in the neutral atmosphere that we see that are responsible for some of the inaccuracies in our prediction of the orbits, for example, are produced by the interaction between the charged and the neutral particles that we've been able to observe for the first time during this final mission phase. So I want to just illustrate those quickly for you by just looking at two main features that are both on this picture here. So I want to just focus on this picture here, which is a map, if you like, of the measurement of the neutral density that the satellite made as it went around the Earth in 24 hours. It takes about 90 minutes for the satellite to go all the way around the Earth in 24 hours. And here's the picture of the density that it measured as it went around the Earth for a period here of in excess of a month up until the last phases of the mission. So this is what the neutral density measurement looks like. And while you might expect the neutral density to sort of be a benign, flat, dull, uninteresting sort of piece of the upper atmosphere, in fact, you can see just from this picture that there are some very extraordinary variations in the density. And it's these variations, many of which are not accurately displayed in the models that we have, but these variations that we require, that we need to know with very high accuracy and fidelity in order to improve our models of the atmosphere and atmospheric drag. So a couple of things that are really interesting that don't show up in the models. And that is this big increase in the density here in the circle. You can see normal densities in the green here, and now a really bright red stripe here that extends all the way across almost at all local times. And this bright red, this very large increase in the density, is accompanied by this decrease in this DST index that Cassandra just got through talking about. And so notice the decrease in the DST that Cassandra was talking about was 200. This is a very small decrease, minus 80, and represents energy input to the atmosphere that's input at high latitudes. And yet the big increases in density we're seeing at the equator, and we see them almost immediately. So very large changes in the density, very small energy inputs at high latitudes that result in these large changes in the density. So this is something that needs to be incorporated with much higher fidelity than we normally have in the models. The other feature that you can see pretty easily here in this circle, but everywhere in this picture, if you look carefully, actually, are these stripes in the density. So there are periodic increases in the density. You can see the scale here. They happen every day. Every day in the same place, the satellite revisits the same place, and the density is bigger there than it is at other places. And the magnitude of the change in these densities, again, is much larger than we see in any model that would predict what this density looks like. And so we have to understand what these stripes are, what they look like, and then how to incorporate them in our next generation of models. It turns out that the instruments on CNOS also measure the plasma density, the charged particle number density, and if I were to show you a map of that, it would have these stripes in here, apparently at the same place. And so now what I'm going to do is just take this little picture here and blow it up and just show you the simultaneous measurements of the plasma density, charged particle density, it's shown in red here, and the neutral density that's shown in blue. So here are the stripes that you saw in the previous plot. But superimposed on are stripes in the plasma density, in the charged particle density too. But you'll notice, I hope, that the peaks are displaced a little bit in the blue. They're displaced a little bit to the right. And if I were to draw a little schematic, it's as if the ionosphere were corrugated with these peaks in it here. And the neutral atmosphere is similarly corrugated, but the peaks represent a pile up of the neutral gas up against these walls of plasma density. This is an effect known as ion drag, where the neutrals are trying to flow through the charged particles, but collisions between those two species pile up the neutrals up against the ions that originally tied to the magnetic field. We understood this phenomena, but would not have predicted the magnitude of the change in the neutral gas density that is produced by this phenomenon. And so we're looking forward to understanding this a little bit more carefully and adding it to our predictive capability of the neutral atmosphere. Thank you. I'll hand over to Rob Pfaff now, who'll tell you a little bit more about the science that we gained from the mission.
Great, thanks very much, Ron. What I'd like to do is actually also show some result from the toward the end of the mission when CNOS was at the low altitudes. But what I'd like to do is tie this back to the original motivation for the CNOS satellite, which was to understand the turbulence that we see in the ionosphere at night at the low latitudes and to try to understand this. This was what Cassandra talked about called troubles with bubbles. Now, I'm going to begin with this sort of picture, which actually is from a ground-based instrument. This is not from CNOS. This is from a powerful NSF-funded radar in Peru. And you might say, why in the world is he showing us this Rorschach ink blot test plot? But actually, this black and white image really, I think, sets the stage for sort of one of the whole main motivation for CNOS. Essentially, this is what we call a range time intensity plot. The range is the altitude here, and then this is versus time. So for the local time, this was around 8:30 p.m. and about an hour and a half of data. And what happened was the radar was looking straight up with the radio waves, and the radio waves were being scattered by the ionosphere. And if the ionosphere was quiescent, there would be no scatter, at least not at this wavelength. Instead, what you see is a very strong signal which occurs right at the base of the ionosphere, here at 400 kilometers. And then as the evening goes on, it actually rises. And as it rises, then the whole ionosphere above it becomes turbulent. We get scale sizes, you know, that vary from hundreds of kilometers down to less than a meter. We see very different high altitude turbulence and low altitude turbulence. And this is what causes wrecks havoc with navigation and communication signals. This was the motivation for CNOS to understand why this happens, where it happens, and to be able to predict why it happens. Then notice later, then the ionosphere comes back down, still very strong signal from the bottom side, but this is only here when it went to high altitudes. When the bottom part of the ionosphere, the ledge, went to higher altitudes. And to show this in another way, this is the model Jeff Clancy and our colleague at Goddard provided. And actually, same thing. Here's the altitudes. Here's the ionospheric density. And as you can see, around sunset, around 20 local time, the ionosphere rises. And I put here the CNOS orbit. This is just one, say, at 300 kilometers. And now we have a chance to go underneath the ionosphere, underneath the ledge, and to actually explore for the first time what's sort of causing all of this turbulence. And so now I'm going to show you the data from CNOS. And of course, we have over 40,000 orbits, but really this is data from three consecutive orbits, again, in the last year of the operations when the perigee was low. And you can actually see the data is the same format in all three. The bottom panel is sort of a map. And the red line is the actual the altitude of the satellite where the data were gathered. The black line is just the footprint on the Earth, and the blue is the magnetic equator. So you can see these were all times when we were taking data at perigee, near sunset, this eclipse bar shows when we went from daylight to night side. And here's the ion density that we measured on board. And you can see there's a very large orders of magnitude cavity when we went below the F peak. Below the F peak is what we call the ionospheric peak. But this is below the ledge of the ionosphere, very large decrease in the plasma density. And then on this top panel, we actually plot the velocity of the ionosphere, the horizontal velocity, as measured by the CNOFS instruments. And as you can see, that when we went below the ionosphere, the direction of this horizontal flow changed markedly from eastward to westward. And you can see that in every case. And this is very common. We have showing that there's the upper ionosphere and the lower ionosphere are going in different directions. And our idea is that this shear in the ionospheric flow, the main flow of the ionosphere, is such that it can produce instabilities and hence produce the irregularities and turbulence that I showed earlier. And it's sort of a diagram showing this, shown here. Here's the ionospheric ledge. Here's that shear I'm talking about. Again, we went below. We saw the shear change. These are the large instabilities that we also measure with the CNOFS instruments. And then as in the nighttime, these evolve into these irregularities and these large-scale bubbles that we talk about how they're rising and causing all the irregularities actually cause the scintillations. So there's been theoretical work on this, some work with the radar community and some sounding rockets. But now is the first time we actually have a dedicated measurements with a satellite on numerous orbits showing that this phenomenon is common and that this change in the shear flow could be a very good candidate for why is the ionosphere becoming turbulent at night. And I should point out that this phenomenon has been studied for decades. And the first time it was observed was 1938 on an ionosonde in Peru. Scientists have been trying to understand this turbulence at night in the ionosphere at low latitudes for many, many decades, and we feel we've made a major contribution with the CNOFS data. Okay, that concludes my talk, but since I'm the last speaker, I have a few points I want to make. The first is we have a session tomorrow morning. If you'd like to come hear some of the scientific papers, there'll also be some posters. But perhaps more importantly, I want to take this opportunity to thank the Air Force for the CNOFS mission. It really was a magnificent mission, 7.5 years of new and important observations. I think the entire international scientific community really tips their hat to the Air Force. Thanks to the Air Force for providing this wonderful data set. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I will now take questions from any reporters in the audience. Please state your name and your affiliation.
Thanks. Hi, it's Alex Witzy with Nature. For whoever would like to take this, can someone talk a little bit about how these results are applicable to other satellites as they're decaying from their orbits, specifically maybe if they're coming down at a different geographic region or time of year or different, you know, during a solar storm or something? Can you just talk about how what you've learned can be directly applied to anyone else who might be deorbiting?
I guess that's working. I think it's important to recognize that the neutral atmosphere has large-scale variations from pole to the equator, for example, and large-scale seasonal variations. And there are quite a few measurements already that have been put together to create a model that describes those variations fairly well. The smaller scale variations and the underlying mechanisms that produce the smaller scale variations, the effects of high energy inputs at high latitudes, for example, and the ion drag kind of processes that I was just talking about, those are less well understood. And so an improvement in the models that allows those smaller scale variations to be included in a general physical way, and not just by location, but more by physical phenomenon, will make a first order improvement to the smaller scale structure in the neutral atmosphere that's important for improving the predictive capability of the orbit.
Are there any other questions from reporters in the room? Are there any questions from reporters on the chat? Any other questions? No? Okay, thank you. That concludes our 4 o'clock press conference. Our next press conference will be at 5 o'clock, the impacts of heat stress on densely populated regions in the 21st century. Thank you.